My name's Sigmund Jurgensen, and I've had the privilege of being the person responsible for Montsalvat for a squillion years. And when I get hold of a microphone, I always like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land, the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation. And of late, I've been acknowledging the traditional builders of Montsalvat, the Jurgensen and Skipper families, just in case they've forgotten. A couple of months ago, I guess, Tony Gould arrived on my doorstep and suggested this concert. We should do a Brian Brown retrospective. And I thought, what a fantastic idea. He did most of the running, and then Roz did a lot more of the running. I sat on my up at Montsalvat, smiling at the world. I had the good fortune, when I returned to Australia to run Montsalvat in 1969, someone came up to me one day and said, "You must go down into the city and hear this guy, Brian Brown." And I did. Now, I've never been a great follower of jazz as a genre of music, but when I heard Brian, I must admit I was blown away. The quartet was and still is, in my mind, one of the greatest quartets ever to come out of Australia. I was so excited by what I had heard, I invited Brian and his quartet to come and perform at Montsalvat. They weren't the first people that I had asked to come to Montsalvat, because I come from a classical music tradition and I'd introduced a couple of classical musicians. And at the time, I, funnily enough, believed that poets should rule the world, don't know why. But and I had Sweeney Reed come and read some poetry, and then Michael Dugan. But Brian joined the assembled players and his quartet, and unlike the rest of them, he continued to perform at Montsalvat in various forms, but usually the quartet, probably for the next 20 years. When I came to do the jazz festivals, it was to his pianist, Bob Sedergreen, I turned, and to Ted Vining, his drummer. Ted can do more than play the triangle. But look, I won't take any more time telling you boring anecdotes of the past. I just think it's a great privilege for all of us to be here today to listen to Brian's music in its many different forms, played by some fantastic musicians, and I thank them all for coming here and giving their time and joining in this retrospective. And always one who loves red wine and white wine, I must acknowledge Richard Foreman, who's providing the wines over in the corner, and urge you to try them. And finally, introduce Tony Gould, who will MC the concert. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, Zig. It's an honour and a pleasure to be here for several reasons. First being Brian, of course. I'll say a few words about Brian in a second. And these incredible musicians that are floating around the space, some of the best in the world, not just nationally, internationally. So we're in for a truly amazing afternoon, actually a rare afternoon when it boils down. As for Brian, I've known Brian for many, many years and played in his quartet for quite a few years and done duets, and we played at the 8th World Saxophone Congress for Classical Saxophone Players in Tokyo. And that was quite scary. If you know the French repertoire for classical saxophone, you have to actually leave the room very, very quickly. Brian was the only improvisers in the whole Congress. Brian has had an amazing influence on many, many people. The people that you'll hear today, students, ex-students, and I will tell you that for me, he changed my whole life for the better, I hope. He is an utterly inspiring man. If I talk too much, I'll get too emotional, but he's changed quite a few people's lives. And I wouldn't be still in music had he not invited me down to the College of the Arts. So I'm seriously, deeply honoured and grateful to you, my friend. You're a special man. And talking about special people, I will mention now, and I might say a little bit later, Roz McMillan has put this concert together largely, conducted a couple of the pieces, organised all the musicians, which is kind of a little bit nightmarish in times. Roz has done an amazing things, not just for Brian, but for music as well. She's a great educator, wonderful human being. So this is, as I said, a very special concert for me and for many of the people that are going to play. And it will be for you too when you hear this extraordinary output of music making and creativity that Brian's been occupied with for many, many years. In fact, I can think of no one else in the world of improvisation that's had more of an impact on music in this country than Brian. I say that quite honestly. So that's... So, needless to say, I have many, many stories about tours and things which might come for another day. We'll get a poet to read them. But this is a day for music making, beautiful music making with some extraordinary musicians. So it's my pleasure to introduce the musicians as we go and make a few comments if it's necessary, and they might make a few comments. We want to keep the talking to a minimum because we need to hear all this incredible music. So please welcome as the first group, and they're playing Digger's Rest, which incidentally, Brian, I heard in a recital a couple of nights ago at the College of the Arts, somebody played Digger's Rest, and it was just fantastic. This quartet is David Martin, piano, a long-time colleague and friend of Brian's, Lachlan Davison, virtuoso saxophone player, woodwind player, Nick Haywood, extraordinary double bass player, and the truly wonderful Ted Vining. Please make them welcome.
It's a great privilege to come here today in terms of the association I've had with Brian Brown. It was 1956, and most of you aren't that age anyway, you know, that when I first met Brian, and I had the privilege to be invited to play in his original quintet. And we played for about 2 years at Jazz Centre 44 in Melbourne, and also the wonderful Keith Hounslow, who's sitting here. So the three of us are the only three left out of that era, and the songs are on an album, the Brian Brown Quintet 1958, with all those songs on it. We had the wonderful Stuart Spears, who was a legend drummer. Brian's always been at the leading edge of creative and improvised music. He's been a true leader, and he's also counselled people and helped people through his career. And I can't think of anybody, as Tony said, in Australia who has been at that leading edge and consistently, and he's still writing quite a lot of music, and the red wine helps the music come out. So I talk to Brian every Christmas, and I call him Digger. And today we're just going to present his song that he composed called Digger's Rest. We used to, it's not like today where all music is printed on Sibelius or Finale programs. Brian had a new song for the band to play, and that's the arrangement of Blues by Fire. You scratch it out, tear it off, this is what we're doing. And Keith, with his ability and his creative ability with his trumpet and pocket trumpet, and Barry Buckley, who I've got to also recognise, you know, were part of that quintet that we were so far ahead of the rest of the musicians in Australia. Brian used to import Miles Davis records back in 56 when we'd listened to The Voice of America. But anyway, please put your hands for Brian and Keith and the quintet as a start.
I've got something I'd like to say about Diggers. Is this on? Yeah, it is on. Yeah, great. I used to go to the Jazz Centre. No, the, not the Jazz Centre. Yeah, Jazz Centre 44. Yeah, yeah. And here, this band, when I was a kid, you know, the Brian Brown Quintet. Yeah. I'm a lot younger than these other guys. So, and I remember I was being turned around from listening to absolute rubbish music of my collection. I suddenly discovered Miles Davis and Sonny Rollins and John Coltrane. And then I used to go down to the Jazz Centre 44 and hear Brian Brown and Keith Hounslow and David and Barry and Stuart Spear, my favourite drummer ever, play. And it was just a fantastic experience. Every Sunday was just wonderful times. Later on, I got to the stage where I started to play a bit and I started to get pretty good at it. And Brownie hadn't played for a while. And Barry Buckley, the late Barry Buckley, had just come back from a two-year stint living in San Francisco. And he and I and a piano player that I discovered playing at the Hampton Hotel named Tony Gould. it was incredible. We played a couple of gigs and it was just a fantastic rhythm section. And I called Brownie and I said, "Hey, Brian, why don't we start a quartet again and get it all going? You know, because I've got this great little rhythm section I think you might enjoy." So we got together, we rehearsed, we played gigs, we played at the Fatback Pussycat, we played at the Downbeat Club, we even did an overseas tour to Hobart, where I live now, yeah. And it was just a fantastic experience. But better still, we decided in those days that the best way to do things and get a regular gig was to open our own club and hire a piano and buy some furniture. So we rented this place in Crosley Street in the city, just down the road from Pellegrini's. And Brownie, who was studying architecture at the time, with Trevor Rees, who's here also, take a bow, Trevor, they were both studying architecture at the time, did all the heavy work, because I'm no good at that. They put a false ceiling in and they built a stage and I painted the walls and my wife then made the curtains and we hired a coffee machine, we hired another piano from Allen's and it was all this wonderful. I went to the Palais de Danse who was selling off its old furniture and I bought 50 Vienna chairs for 50 cents each, right? we put them in there, and we started this club, which was fantastic, and it went for the usual term for jazz club in Melbourne, a little while. There was a nightclub down the other end of the room, a disco that had fights going on all the time out the front and down our alleyway, so a lot of people stayed away. But we established our own gig, and we spared no amount of cash on promoting it. This was the This was our handbill that we put out, that I wrote. This is my first attempt at copywriting, actually. And it says, "Attention jazz enthusiasts. Where in our fair city can you go to hear some jazz? Hmm? Up until now, pretty well nowhere. Eh? Well, a new scene is about to happen. It's Diggers Rest. It happens Friday through Sunday at 8:30 p.m. commencing Friday the 22nd of the 7th, 1966. This scene has been organised and is being run by the jazz musicians you can see and hear live at Diggers Rest. Such names as Brian Brown, Keith Hounslow, who's here, Tony Gould, Barry Buckley, Ted Vining, John Leslie, Barry Morton, Graham Morgan, Jeff Bartram, John Grunden, and many others will appear each week at Diggers Rest. Our policy is modern jazz for jazz's sake, so make it a must to visit. Two groups will alternate each night, coffee too. You'll find us at the Crosley in Crosley Street, right next to Pellegrini's at the groovy end of the city. Diggers Rest for dead set, walk up, start, proper jazz. P.S. Coltrane lives."
Yes, one afternoon of this is not enough, is it? Because there's some extraordinary stories to be told over a very long period of time, some incredibly funny, most of them incredibly funny, as a matter of fact. And while I'm talking about Keith's been mentioned several times, Keith has a new book out called Oh Looketh Ahead, Babe, and it's here for sale over there with the CDs that I'll mention later of Brian. So as a very memorable thing, you might have a look at those CDs in this book. At the end of the day, they're there and they're freely available, but they're not free. let me introduce this other, the next group. And on Lachlan Davison is going to play flute this time. Nick Hayward on bass. Ted, you've heard, wonderful Ted. And in my opinion, one of the best jazz pianists in the world. And he may not be playing the blues today, but certainly one of the best jazz blues pianists that I've ever had the privilege of hearing and in fact playing with. Please make him welcome Bob Zettergreen.
Now, I'm not going to say a very much sorry. Normally when I go to a jazz gig, a whole lot of stuff gets said on the microphone, but everything that's been said so far has been so spot on, I'll just shut up and go and play. Love you, Brownie, you're part of my life. Thank you.
I'm Ros McMillan, and it's my great pleasure to introduce Tony Gould, who is our next performer. What can I say about Tony? Everybody knows Tony. He is a marvellous musician, a tremendous educator. In fact, he is, I think, almost my favourite pianist in the whole world, because he is also a classical pianist as well as a jazz pianist. And listening to some of his pieces, such as the Irish tunes that he has on a CD, is tremendously inspiring and makes me, as a non-jazz pianist, feel that I can actually do some improvisation, and I owe a huge debt to Tony. This piece he's going to play is a lovely piece that Brian wrote in 1976. I read in The Age that Billy Hyde had died, and Brian went straight into the music studio and came out an hour later with this beautiful piece, Song for Billy Hyde. And Brian and Billy played in the IMT Orchestra with Graham Kennedy for many, many years, and they were very, very good mates. And of course, Bill was absolutely crucial to In Melbourne Tonight. And while the rest of the band played the set pieces, Billy always had to be waiting in case Graham made a gag so that he could make a drum roll. And it was a very tough gig for Billy Hyde. And so it was a sad day when Billy died, but this beautiful piece has been written and it gets played a great deal. It's one of the pieces that I play a lot, and it really is a lovely piece. So please welcome Tony Gould.
Thank you.
for reminding me how beautiful that piece was. I hadn't heard it for quite a few years, and she brilliantly brought me to understand what the music was like. Is the microphone working?
No, put it on.
It's on. Oh, hell with it, I'll talk like this. So if you didn't hear that, I've got Roz to thank for that, reminding me how beautiful that song was. And of course it is magical. Reminds me of, in a sense, kind of early French music, like Eric Satie's music. It's not complicated, it's just exquisitely beautiful, with shifts of modes that you don't come across in your normal jazz language. So that just, it's another demonstration of what Brian's creativity is like through the times. You hear vast variety, really creative music. So before we have interval, I'd like to introduce this next group. Bob's going to play piano again. Piano, Lachlan Davidson soprano saxophone, and two, I say newcomers in the sense that you'll know what I mean. The wonderful Jeff Kluke, double bass, who has been a stalwart for double bass players in this city and earlier in Adelaide, of course, played with all the great musicians, as most of my colleagues have too, and the most beautiful drummer too, Michael Jordan. Please make them welcome. Just play Rainbow.
There's one thing I do want to say that is very important to me. Music to me are people, and as Brian Brown told me once, music changes with the times, and you can hear through this concert, you'll hear the changing times as from Digger's Rest, and we're going forward, as Brian would say, onward and forward. But today's very special for me in that I did a lot of gigs with Brian, and one of the gigs we did was a television gig. As a matter of fact, Jeff Clerk was on that gig, and Virgil Nunnally played drums. He's not here today, but that's okay. And on that gig was, of course, Brian's beautiful daughters, Chantel and Katya. They were playing strings beautifully. They dressed immaculately and played just gorgeously. And a big highlight for me today was going backstage. They had some food out there. Ros had some chicken and baklava and, of course, there were wine. There was no party, but that's because you weren't there, Brownie. But basically, Brian's granddaughters were there, Lily and Ella. And it was just such a thrill for me, being a family guy, to see Lily and Ella here and playing later on in the concert. Thank you very much.